So and today I will talk on angiogenesis again, but that time not on VEGF family. That is has been the subject of our research in the last 15 years, but by new activity of IgG1 as a class of molecule, as an anti-angiogenic molecule via Fc-gamma receptor 1. I have just few slides of introduction, and as many of you know, angiogenesis is associated to a plethora of disease that can be divided in the disease in which there is a pathological increase in vascularization, and this is the list of the main disease, as well as in pathology in which there is a decreased vascularization. Also you know that for inhibition of pathological angiogenesis, now there are several drugs that are delivered in patients, in particular for cancer and for ocular neovascular disease. But angiogenesis now is considered one of the must for therapy in human because it has been evaluated that during our life, about one third of world population impact on disease in which angiogenesis is involved. So it's a very important target for therapy. And angiogenesis is a complex phenomenon, and of course there are many molecular players that are involved in modulation of angiogenesis. Of course the most important is the VEGF family, but this is a list of the factor for which has been described involvement in angiogenesis, as well as several kinds of cells, and also the presence of some conditions such as hypoxia or permeabilization and inflammation. Despite in the last year, a great effort has been produced to try to generate different kind of drugs to target angiogenesis. Up to now, the only real target for therapy is the VEGF family. This is just a scheme of the member involved in the formation of blood vessels and the related receptors. And practically, we have a monoclonal antibody, bevacizumab or Avastin, that blocks VEGF-A. The Fab fragment derived from this antibody, the ranizumab, that is exclusively used for ocular disease. The most recent biological drug is aflibercept, that is generated, is a recombinant protein that is formed by domain 2 of receptor 1 and domain 3 of receptor 2, fused to a Fc of IgG1 that is able to block the three proangiogenic members of the family, so VEGF-A, PLGF, and VEGF-B. And the application are for bevacizumab and aflibercept in cancer. This is the list of cancer for which bevacizumab is normally used. And then we have a huge number of TK inhibitors that block the receptors. Of course, TK inhibitors are never specific, so this is for each molecule the list of receptors that are targeted by these molecules. And for example, the antiangiogenics become the first line for metastatic renal cell carcinoma or also neuroendocrine tumors. And the Fab fragment of Avastin, ranibizumab, has been developed for the application of age-related macular degeneration. But after off-label, you know the story between Avastin and Lucentis, is used also aflibercept, bevacizumab, Avastin, and now also aflibercept has been approved for the ocular neovascular disease. The data that I present you start for a simple observation that in collaboration with Jay Ambati of the University of Lexington in Kentucky, we did together. So we I want to say that we are in the era of antibody-based therapy. There are more than 30 monoclonal antibody in therapy. There are about 500 ongoing clinical trials. And for this study, and the great part of them are IgG1-based molecules. And for this story, I will talk also about another therapeutic, the human intravenous immunoglobulin. It is a preparation of immunoglobulin from plasma, pooled plasma of thousands of donors. And this is approved for primary immunodeficiencies, but is also used off-label for several inflammatory diseases or for transplantation. And also, in this case, the great part of the preparation for 75-70% is formed by IgG1. As I say you before, all start with this simple observation. Bevacizumab, so Avastin, the monoclonal antibody anti-human VEGF-A, is specific for human protein. It is not able to bind to mouse protein. Despite this fact, there are several papers that claims that bevacizumab works in mice. In all these papers, unfortunately, the control was salin and not in an isotype matched antibody. So we just asked to us, how is it possible? And then we decided to verify, and as you can see, bevacizumab is able to block the phosphorylation of receptor 2 stimulated by human VEGF-A, not the R2 phosphorylation stimulated by mouse VEGF-A. At the same time, ranibizumab is able to inhibit the activation stimulated by human VEGF-A, not the stimulation of receptor stimulated with mouse VEGF-A. And when we try in the model of choroid neovascularization, effectively, bevacizumab was able to inhibit angiogenesis, ranibizumab not. So we start to think that this activity was target independent, but was due to another function that antibody may have. First of all, we decide to evaluate if this is true in other angiogenesis mouse model. This is the neovascularization of cornea, and we start also to use generic human IgG1. And as you can see, bevacizumab and generic human IgG1 are able to inhibit angiogenesis, and our control ranibizumab not. We other laboratory confirmed that in choroid neovascularization bevacizumab works, ranibizumab no, and also generic human IgG1 was able to inhibit angiogenesis. Then we move to different models, models that are not in the eye. So we did Int'l limb ischemia. And as you can see, both bevacizumab and IgG1 was able to reduce the blood flow by laser Doppler analysis. When we did the histochemical analysis, we evaluated by evaluating the ratio between ischemic and non-ischemic legs normalized on the number of myocytes. We observed again that bevacizumab was able to inhibit angiogenesis like the generic IgG1, and the Fab fragment was unable to do this. And finally, we move also to, up to this experiment, we have delivered locally the drugs, or in the eye by intravitreal or intracorneal injection, or in the case of Int'l limb ischemia by intramuscular injection. About the dosage, I want to now show the dosage. This is the dosage that are used in human with the relative volume of the compartment, and this is the volume in mouse. And for the experiment in cornea, we use this amount that is compatible with the dosage in human. For the choroid neovascularization, we obtained the effect with an increased dosage. For the muscle, there is not reference, so we use the same ratio of volume that we have used for vitreous. And then for IVIg, I discovered that in human, this drug is delivered at very incredible high dosage, 0.5 up to 2 gram kilos. And we did also experiment with IVIg by intravitreal injection. So I was scared to use this very high concentration, but there is a mathematical formula to evaluate, move from dosage in animals to human and vice versa, that is FDA approved. And this is the KM factor that is different from species to species and it depends from body surface area. And if we apply this formula, we can use up to this concentration. So as you can see in mouse, we have used concentration that are lower compared to the limit that we can use. For example, in the case of the IVIg, we can use in mouse up to 25 gram kilo based on this formula. Of course, we have used the same dosage that have been normally used in humans. So after the data obtained with the bevacizumab and ranibizumab, we move to evaluate if also IVIg intravenous immunoglobulin are able to inhibit angiogenesis. And as you can see, when we deliver IVIg intracorneally or intravitreally, we still observe an inhibition of angiogenesis. And interestingly, we start to deliver the IVIg also systemically. And as you can see, also the systemic delivery was able to inhibit choroidal angiogenesis. This is a dose-dependent experiment, and this is a very important experiment because the delivery of drugs occur by intravitreal injection, while this is an effect observed by systemic injection. We evaluated also what happens in the limb ischemia model by systemic delivery of IVIg, and also in this case we were able to observe an inhibition of blood flow recovery by laser Doppler analysis, and once again an important reduction of neovascularization by immunohistochemical analysis. And the possibility to deliver IVIg at high concentration allowed us to evaluate also the effect on the tumor model. And this is a model of xenograft colorectal cancer. And we used 0.5 and 2 gram kilo of IVIg, and we have a dose-dependent inhibition of tumor growth. We evaluated also a syngenic model, a fibrosarcoma with the T241 cell lines in C57 strain. And as you can see, we with IVIg still observe an important inhibition of tumor growth. And to this inhibition of tumor growth corresponded an inhibition of neovascularization evaluated by immunohistochemical analysis both in syngenic and in xenograft tumors. So the first, this set of data allowed us to affirm that IgG1 and IVIg are able to inhibit angiogenesis at least in four different models of mouse angiogenesis. So if the antibody doesn't work via Fab interaction with antigen, because I explained to you that bevacizumab did not recognize mouse and generic human IgG works, of course we start to imagine that this activity is due to the Fc portion that, as you know, interact with several kind of Fc gamma receptors located on different kind of cells. So first of all, we cut the bevacizumab in Fab and Fc portion, and we evaluated this, if the Fc alone is able to inhibit angiogenesis. So we prepared the two parts of the molecule, and as you can see, the bevacizumab Fc is able to inhibit corneal and choroidal angiogenesis. This is bevacizumab, this is IVIg, preparation of Fc. So when we use just the Fc portion of antibody, we still continue to see inhibition, while the Fab portion was not effective. We evaluated the activity of IVIg Fc and IVIg Fab also in tumor, and this is the model, the xenograft model. And as you can see, with IVIg Fc, we were able to see a strong inhibition of tumor growth compared to the control, and the IVIg Fab doesn't work. So the activity is confined to Fc portion. This is the analysis of vascularization of the IVIg Fc activity. Then we can add to our list that the angioinhibition activity resides in the Fc portion of the molecule. We are working with bevacizumab, that is IgG1, but you know that this is also IgG2, IgG3, and IgG4 in human. So we want to understand if there is an IgG1 specific effect. And to do this, we used six different monoclonal antibodies used for human therapy. None of these antibodies recognize mouse counterpart. And all are IgG1, except denosumab, that is an IgG2 molecules. And when we perform experiments, as you can see, all the monoclonal antibody IgG1 based give inhibition of angiogenesis in cornea and in choroid, while the denosumab, that is an IgG2 molecule, was ineffective. So indicating that probably IgG1 are the isotype that give this kind of data. You know that the Fc binds to Fc gamma receptor, and for example, glycosylation of Fc is crucial for the binding to the receptor. So we prepared deglycosylated bevacizumab, and when we do this, the activity was loose. This is the buffer, and this is the MOC, so indicating that is important also. The glycosylation, so the binding of the molecule to the Fc gamma receptor to exert this effect. This was also confirmed by a peptide that we isolated several years ago together with Dr. Ruvo in Technogen. And this is, and Menotti will talk about this peptide more in detail. I want just to say that this peptide is able to inhibit the interaction between IgG and Fc gamma receptors. So we use this peptide to verify that if we inhibit this interaction, we expect to lose the angioinhibitory effect. And this is what happens with the peptide inhibitor. With this peptide, this is a scrambled control peptide. And this was true in choroidal neovascularization as well as in the limbic schema. Once again, we were able to abolish the effect of IgG using this peptide. The control peptide doesn't work. So we can say that the angioinhibition activity is IgG1 specific and require binding to one of the receptors. Then next step was to try to identify which of the receptors is involved in this activity. And to do this, I have to show you a scheme of the receptor because there is not cross. There are not the same nomenclature for mouse and human IgG. This is the receptor in human. We have essentially three activating receptors with ETAM domain and one, and one with the inhibition domain. Here you can see that the IgG1 bind to high affinity, the Fc gamma receptor 1 with high affinity, as well as to the IgG4, and while the IgG2 are not able to bind to the receptor 1, but is able to has the capacity to bind to the other receptors. This is the situation in mouse, in which of course we work. We have also in this case three activating receptors called R1, R3, and R4, and we have the receptor R2B. That, like the 2B in human, is an inhibiting receptor. Of course, just to complicate the story, in mouse, the IgG1 corresponds to human IgG2 because it is able to bind to inhibiting receptor and not to high affinity receptor, while the IgG2A or 2C for an allelic variant in C57 correspond to human IgG1 because bind to high affinity to receptor 1 and do not bind to receptor 2. But for the data that I show you is important to see what happens in terms of cross interaction. And the human IgG1 bind to high affinity to receptor 1 and to lower affinity to the receptor 2B, 3, and 4, like the 2 in mouse. And IgG2 does not bind to receptor 1, so in our case is denosumab as example, but bind to other receptor. So based on this situation, we start to do experiment in several knockouts model in which single or more Fc gamma receptor have been ablated. So first of all, we use the Fc gamma chain minus minus mice. In these mice, the gamma chain that is common to the activating receptor has been deleted. So the unique working receptor is the receptor 2B. And in this case, as you can see, the IgG1 does not are not able to inhibit angiogenesis. Another model that we used was the 5 knockout mouse, in which the receptor 1, 2, and 3 have been deleted, 1, 2, and 3, and in addition also two receptors for IgGE. So the only working receptor is the 4. And also in this case, we don't observe inhibition. Then we move to the knockout for the single activating receptors, so for knockout for R1 or R3 or R4. And as you can see, when we knock out the receptor 3 or the receptor 4, we still see angioinhibition when we deliver immunoglobulins, while in the receptor 1 knockout mice, the activity was loose. So this means that, of course, all this data seems to indicate that the receptor 1 is important for this effect. So in the receptor 1 minus minus mice, we perform also in the limb schema experiment. And also in this case, we lose the ability of IVIg to inhibit angiogenesis. And also we use two more models. And as you can see, this is the fibrosarcoma in C57 mice, and we practically lose the ability of IVIg to inhibit tumor growth and to inhibit angiogenesis. So this set of data allowed us to indicate that the receptor 1 is necessary for the activity. Next, to try to understand the mechanism, and you know that the gamma receptors are widely expressed on cells that come from the bone marrow, in the myeloid cell lines. So to be sure that this kind of cells are involved in this angioinhibition mechanism, we performed a bone marrow transplantation experiments. And when we transplant bone marrow from wild type to receptor 1 minus minus mice, we obtain inhibition by IgG1. When we transplant the bone marrow from R1 minus minus mice to wild type, we don't have inhibition. So indicating that, of course, the bone marrow has an important role. About the expression of Fc gamma receptor, this is one of the many pictures that you can find on review of receptor. So what is important to underline that the receptor 1 is essentially expressed on monocyte macrophage cells. And this is the different level of expression of the different kind of receptor. Also, if recent data seems to show that Fc gamma receptor 1 is essentially expressed or exclusively expressed on monocyte macrophage cells. But in any case, who is involved in angiogenesis know that monocyte macrophages play a crucial role during pathological angiogenesis. Then our attention was on this kind of cells. And first of all, we evaluated the effect on migration because the recruitment of these cells is crucial. So the ability of stimulate the migration of monocyte macrophages is crucial. And as you can see, when we stimulate angiogenesis with the VGFA on bone marrow-derived macrophages, we observed that in presence of bevacizumab or genetic human IgG1, the migration was inhibited. And this, of course, does not occur in bone marrow-derived cells from Fc gamma receptor 1 minus minus mice. So indicating that almost one of the activity of IgG1 on these cells is the ability to prevent the monocyte macrophage migration simulated by VGFA. And first of all, we verify on the four models that we have used in vivo, if the effectively we have an inhibition of monocyte macrophage recruitment in cornea, choroid, muscle, and tumors. And effectively, we observe an inhibition of monocyte macrophage recruitment with different scale of effects. In choroid, we have a nice inhibition. In cornea, it was not so fantastic. But in muscles, at day four after ischemic insult, we observe an important inhibition of monocyte macrophage recruitment. And in the model of fibrosarcoma, still treated with IVIg, we observe an inhibition of monocyte macrophage recruitment. So it seems that in the whole models, effectively, we have, after treatment with IgG1 or IVIg, an inhibition of monocyte macrophage recruitment. And this was also true in the additional model of tumor in the xenograft colorectal cancer, in which the inhibition was really important. And it was also true when we treated the animals with IVIg FC and not with IVIg FAAB. So all data seems to indicate that there is this inhibition. So how how occurred the block of recruitment of monocyte macrophages when we treated the animals with immunoglobulin? So this is the most important signal transduction pathway activated by interaction with immunoglobulin and Fc gamma receptor. We did several analyses, but we were very interested to the CBL activation because CBL is a molecule that is able to generate ubiquitination on several TK receptors, tyrosine kinase receptors, and degradation of the receptors. And since we observed that the migration of bone marrow-derived cells stimulated by VEGFA was inhibited by the presence of IgG or IVIg, and since one of the most important receptors for the migration of monocyte macrophages is the vascular endothelial growth factor receptor 1, we start to verify if this way may be involved in the mechanism that I am talking about. So first of all, we introduced another mouse model, not a mice, in which the gamma chain is not deleted, but just mutated, just point mutation to avoid the signal transduction. This is because it has been observed that in the mouse in which this chain has been deleted, the expression level of the receptor was alterated. And this is because we used bone marrow-derived cells from wild-type or not-an mice. And when we stimulated with immunoglobulins, as you can see, we observed the phosphorylation of CBL, all in wild-type, but not in not-an mice. So indicating that the activation of CCBL occurs in presence of IgG. This is also true in vivo. These are extracts from cornea. The bevacizumab FC are able to activate the phosphorylation of CBL, not the Fab fragment. And we also used the knockout for CCBL. And as you can see, both in cornea and in choroid vascularization, we lose the angioinhibitory effect of IgG1. So indicating that the activation of CBL is crucial in this activity. And this also was also confirmed in a model in which there is a single mutation of CBL that abolishes the ability of CCBL to work as a protein ubiquitination and degradation. And also in this case, the angioinhibition was loose. So indicating that it's important the activity of CBL, of CCBL, but is important the activity as that activated the protease degradation way. And then we finally evaluated on bone marrow-derived macrophages what happens to the vascular endothelial growth factor receptor 1. And as you can see, the treatment with the bevacizumab effectively determined a degradation of vascular endothelial growth factor receptor 1. Of course, this does not occur in bone marrow derived cells obtained from NOTAM mice. So for sure, one of the activity of IgG1 is the activation of CBL and the degradation of vascular endothelial growth factor receptor 1. Also the classical protein activated by to transduce the signal activated by vascular endothelial growth factor receptor 1, so the activation of PI3 or PLC, is inhibited in presence of bevacizumab, so indicating that probably all the activation way is inhibited. Other than degradation, also we have also very recently observed that another important possible mechanism of antiangiogenesis by these cells, because it has been reported that the activation of Fc gamma receptor determined upregulation of soluble receptor 1, that, as many of you know, is one of the most potent antiangiogenic molecule. And so we have evaluated, this is has been done on extract from muscles derived from Int'l in ischemia, and we evaluated the level of VEGF-A, VEGF-C, soluble receptor 2, and soluble receptor 1 in samples treated with PBS or bevacizumab or ranibizumab. And as you can see, only in the sample treated with Avastin with bevacizumab, we observed an upregulation of soluble FLT1. That so if from one side we were able probably to prevent the recruitment of monocyte macrophages, we were also able with this mechanism to upregulate soluble FLT1 for antiangiogenic effect. And this is just we used a specific antibody for soluble FLT1, and we were able to observe the presence of soluble FLT1 in interfiber space in muscles. Soluble FLT1 result expressed also in control, or where there is or where we treat with ranibizumab, and then we have to evaluate also quantitatively now if in terms of protein we have an upregulation of soluble receptor 1. So we can say that IgG1 Fc gamma receptor 1 prevent monocyte macrophage recruitment thanks to the activation of CCBL and VEGFR1 degradation, and at the same time it seems to increase the soluble R1 production. So if we have to confirm this data, of course, also in the other models. Now I'll show you a few slides that comes also from the discussion with referee when we try to publish this data. You know that antibody works with several kinds of mechanisms other than recognized specific targets, such as antibody-dependent cytotoxicity, or phagocytosis, or complement-derived activation. So our data seems to exclude this mechanism because only the Fc works, and we don't need that the Fab portion of the molecule recognize a specific antigen. Indeed, we have showed that different IgG1 antibody with different Fab works. We have showed that only the Fc portion of bevacizumab or generic IgG1 or from IVIg works. So we don't need the Fab portion of the molecule. And then, in addition, we have showed that IgG1 inhibited corneal and choroidal angiogenesis in mice that lack Fc gamma 3 and 4, that are both important for ADCC or ADCP. Additional data are that, for example, we have used another knockout, L2RG-minus mice, that are practically deficient in NK cells. And also in this case, we were able to see inhibition stimulated by IgG1. So we can reasonably exclude the ADCC or ADCP mechanism. In addition, there is the complement activation. We use another knockout model in which the first protein of the complement cascade is degraded. This is the protein that interacts with the Fc portion of the molecule of the IgG. And also in this case, we were still able to see inhibition in presence of IgG1. And finally, another mouse model, Drug2 mice. In these mice, there is not lymphocyte B and T, so there is not immunoglobulins. There is no production of immunoglobulins. And then we don't have antibody response in these mice. And also in this case, we were able to see inhibition of angiogenesis stimulated by IgG1. And finally, we show that we ask if in FcyRI gamma minus mice and also in RAG2 mice, so in mice in which there is not R1 or in which there is not production of immunoglobulin, if this system, IgG1 Fc gamma receptor 1 interaction, may also modulate physiological angiogenesis. And we evaluated the development of retina neovascularization that occur in postnatal life. So when the mice born, the retina is in the retina there are no vessels, and in the first 8-9 days of the life, the vessels starting from the area of the optical nerve start to vascularize all the retina. And then we can stop, for example, this is a this experiment has been stopped at P6, and then you can evaluate the quantity of vascularization occurred. And as you can see, in Fc gamma receptor 1 minus mice, we have more area of retina vascularized compared to wild type. And the same occurs in mice in which there is not antibody. So if we eliminate IgG1, or if we eliminate the receptor 1, we have an increased physiological vascularization. And another important point that I want to underline is that in the compartment, in the organs, normally there is a very low concentration of immunoglobulin. This is the quantification of serum or the compartment which we did experiments after animal perfusion. As you can see, there is a very low quantity of immunoglobulin in the tissue. And this is after the injection of human IgG. And this is a ratio between human and mouse IgG. So when we deliver high concentration of human immunoglobulin in tissue in which angiogenesis, pathological angiogenesis, is ongoing, in this case, we can find in the tissue sufficient amount of immunoglobulin that can justify the activity that we observe. And this is just to show you, this is a, can you switch off the light, please? Can you just to an immunofluorescence with anti-human IgG in mouse tissue? And as you can see, we have a very huge amount of immunoglobulin in the extra vessel area. This is a muscle section. You can see also in the interfiber space the immunoglobulin. And this is what occurs in tumors. So we have a very huge amount of human immunoglobulin in the tissue in which angiogenesis is occurring. So we can also add to our list that the IgG-induced angiosuppression is independent from ADCC, ADCP, CDC, and that this pathway seems also to modulate physiological angiogenesis. Okay, I have just the last 3 or 4 slides. And up to now, we have talked about human immunoglobulin in mouse, but it may work also on human situation, on human receptors. There is another mouse model that is widely used to evaluate the activity of human immunoglobulin in mouse. And this is the Fc gamma receptor humanized mice, in which all the set of Fc gamma receptor of mouse have been substituted with human receptor, including included the regulatory sequences. So this is a very model, a standard model that is used to verify the activity of human immunoglobulin in mouse. And also in these mice, we were able to see inhibition activated by bevacizumab, so IgG1, not by IgG2, because the denosumab is IgG2. And also IVIg are able to give this kind of effect. In this case, we are talking about corneal and choroid neovascularization. So also IVIg is able to inhibit, still inhibit angiogenesis. And also on the human PBMC, we were able to see the activation of CBL and the degradation of the vascular endothelial growth factor receptor 1 once we stimulated the cells with immunoglobulin. And this is very limited data, because the number of patients is low. But just to show you, because of course, as you know, it's not easy to recover human specimen to this kind of analysis. But we had the opportunity to analyze 12 patients that were treated with IVIg for kidney graft rejection. And we have just 3 patients treated with plasmapheresis as a negative control. And this simple scan from Prague. And we also another set of patients. In this case, the disease treated was the inflammatory myopathies. We have a total of only 10 patients, so not so much. This here is reported the schedule, so treatment, and the analysis we done was performed on biopsy that came just before the treatment, at the end of the treatment. And so this is just to evaluate if the delivery of IVIg may in some way inhibit angiogenesis in patients, in the organ patients. And the answer, analyzing this very low number of samples, was yes. For all 3 cases, of both cases, both in muscle and in kidney, we observed a reduction of vascularization compared to the patients treated with plasmapheresis. Of course, we need to increase the number of samples, but there is almost an indication that the clinical dosage of IVIg may modulate blood vessel density, so raising a potential off-target concern. So, in conclusion, we have shown, I hope that we have shown clearly that human IgG1 interacting with Fc gamma receptor 1 is able to activate CCBL that by ubiquity inhalation is able to degrade vascular endothelial growth factor receptor 1 and then to prevent the recruitment of macrophages. We are now, of course, continue to characterize the story of soluble FLT1 and understand what happens in this case. We have excluded the involvement of a DCC, a DCP, and CDC for the angioinhibition effect we have observed. We have shown that there is also a modulation of physiological angiogenesis, and that clinical dose seems to modulate blood vessel density, so raising a potentially off-target effect of full-length human IgG1 and IVIg in patients. This is the 2 manuscripts that derive from this work, in which there are much more data that I have not time to show, that have been published at the end on the signal transduction and targeted therapy. And I want to thank the collaborators, Jay and Bati. This job is completely shared with Jay. And Jeff Werbeck, that has all the possible knockout of Fc gamma receptor that may imagine he has produced this. And Pierre Brandt from Institut Pasteur, it was our immunologist in the story. And Ingrid Landenberg and Andrei Vikikli for the human specimen, of course, the grant agency. And the people of my small group, in particular for this job, I would thank Laura Tulisco and Valeria Cicatello. And thank you for your attention.